This is Ham Radio Now, episode 280. And I've tried three times to say 280. Episode 280. Just finally got it out. The P25 Network Exchange, that is worldwide repeater linking on the P25 mode. It's from the 2016 ARRL and Tapper Digital Communications Conference down in St. Petersburg, Florida, in September 2016. Still 2016 as I record this. Not quite Thanksgiving. This is my Johnson P25 radio. There used to be a couple of good P25 repeaters around this area, throughout Raleigh, North Carolina area. One of the local guys who works at a two-way shop had put them up. And now they are all DMR Moto Turbo. Back in the day, maybe a decade or so, a lot of P25 repeaters around. I even included P25 as one of the modes that hams used in my old digital voice for amateur radio DVD that I produced back in 2008. So, along with D-Star, in fact, P25 was probably in use before D-Star, just a little bit, kind of about the same time in the early 2000s. And the reason for P25 getting started was that by the late 90s, around 2000, P25 had been in use for a decade. And that's about as long as a fire department or a police department wants to use radios. They age them out, even if they're still in pretty good shape. Sell them cheap, hams buy them up, especially hams that work in the two-way shops and see them coming in as trade-ins. And so they got into ham radio that way. So P25 is one of our earliest digital modes. But they were all standalone repeaters, or there wasn't any linking. And I've often said that in order to get a sort of a niche mode, like any digital mode going in a town, the handful of people that are interested in operating it, getting on the repeater and buying the radios, can be pretty small. So when D-Star came around and they had linking right away, that's what helped it become popular, because you had traffic on that repeater in town that only had three or four local people using it. But traffic from all over the country or all over the world, and kind of made the repeater more useful. And I had said there was no linking on P25, but turns out I was wrong. There is linking. The P25 NX Network Exchange, and that's what this program is going to be all about. So yay, got linking. However, we're still at that state where we have incompatible digital modes. And so here are my three digital radios. There's the Johnson P25. There's the newest one that I've got. This is the DMR, the Tytera TYT, and the ICOM D-Star IC92. So yay, there's digital, but boo, too many radios. If I tried to wear these all, especially this one, this is, you know, good for building up your biceps. It's heavy commercial radio. And they would weigh down my belt.
Evidently I am ham sexy.
We're all a little bit ham sexy.
Now, that's another story. We've talked about that before. We will talk about it again. David will tell all about the P25 stuff. So the Ham Radio Now presentation of videos from the ARRL and Tapper Digital Communications Conference was supported by, doing the video part, not the conference itself, doing the video, supported by a Kickstarter. In that Kickstarter, 75 hams coughed up about a little over $6,000, and three of them came in at the corporate underwriter level. And they were $500. So I talk about them just a little bit extra. And the first one is Tapper itself. Tapper does anything digital in ham radio, software, hardware, modes, operation. If you are interested in digital stuff in ham radio, stop by Tapper, TAPR.org, and think about becoming a member and supporting what they do. And they'll be back next year with the DCC. I'll be at Dayton and some other ham fests and stuff. tapper.org. Number two on the hit parade is this guy, Chud. He is M1PUP and 2E1BXW. Chud is in London in the UK. He does worldwide projects providing technical project management, design, and build in telecommunication systems, security systems, SCADA, command and control systems, mainly in the police, ambulance, and rail sector. You can contact him by email at chud, C-H-U-D, at nodesystems.co.uk, or you can follow him on Twitter. And he tweets and retweets a lot of interesting technical stuff. He's at, this is the way they do it on Twitter, at Node Systems. And finally, the youth thing. Remember that guy said $500? Talk about getting young people in. Maybe give them a book. Maybe give them a book. But what I want to talk about right now is the advice that some of the folks that I've seen tossing back things because I asked have said, and that is get them on the air. You can get them on the air on your ham equipment, and they'll get an idea of what it's all about. But they may like to play, especially the younger kids, may like to play with the radios themselves. And they may have had phones, may have some internet communication, things like that. But playing with radios could still spark some interest. So what I'm going to recommend is that you get some of these guys, the FRS radios. FRS is a family radio service. I use them. It's an unlicensed band, and you can do just about anything you want. You can use them for business. You can play just about anything you want. I use them for ham radio now when I'm working with a crew at a ham fest or something, because I don't want to use ham radio to coordinate, but I want to use something. So it's just a little intercom. If you've seen me at Dayton or Orlando or one of the ham fests, you probably see me communicating with whatever crew I've got with these radios. But they also could be fun to play with. FRS has got 14 channels. Just about every radio these days comes with another 7 channels worth of GMRS. And technically, GMRS requires a license. The FCC was going to, in fact, they had a proposal out. I don't think it's still active. They had a proposal out asking for comments. What if we made this an unlicensed band? Because it's de facto unlicensed now, at least at this level it is. Because although the paperwork that you get with this radio does tell you that certain channels, like channels 1 through 7 and then 15 through 22, are GMRS and require a license, and they tell you where to go get one, and it's expensive. And I'm sure most people completely ignore it, and they ignore what channels they're on. This radio puts out a little bit more power on the GMRS-capable channels. And channel 1 through 7 overlap FRS. Then 8 through 14 are FRS only, and then 15 through 22 are GMRS only. So if I'm on channel 1 through 7 or 15 through 22 and I push the button, I think this is a watt, maybe 2 watts. On the FRS channels, it's a half a watt. There's a little extra button down here I could push on any of the channels to make sure I'm only at a half a watt. It could stay legal. No one pays any attention to that. I got a speaker mic. That's what's stuck on top here. Makes it convenient for use at the events. So you get some of these. You buy them in a blister pack at a drugstore or outdoor shops, Best Buy, electronics stores. Radio Shack's probably still got them. If you can find a Radio Shack, they will advertise range of 15, 25, 35, 50 miles. And if you're a ham and you've operated any VHF and UHF, you know that that's ridiculous. But it's a sort of advertising war between the manufacturers to see who can make the wildest claim. A half watt radio with that little stubby antenna on it. I've done some tests with some of these radios, and a lot of other people have too. And for good solid communication, we're talking about a half a mile. At a half a mile, almost no matter what you do, you're going to get through and not have much noise. At about a mile, you're starting to have to find the right hotspots, and you can get some dropouts. at the 2 mile point, which is what most people say is the useful range for most of these radios, I found that you really have to pick your spot. You can be 2 miles from someone. And if you're both in the right spot, you can, in a hot spot, you can communicate just fine, but it's real easy to drop out. So half mile, pretty good. 1 mile, sort of. 2 miles, pretty much maxing it out. And that's on steady ground, even ground, without any obstructions. You get buildings and other stuff, a mountain in between you. Cindy and I use it skiing. And when there's a mountain in between us, forget it. You're not going to talk very far at all. But kids could enjoy the radio aspect and get to play with their own. And that's the way I started, you know, back with cheap CB walkie-talkies. Could still work today. I don't know. If you are in Europe, outside of North America, America and U.S. And Canada, there's this thing called PMR. PMR 446 is the official name of it. And it's interesting because the spectrum is reallocated. And around here, the frequency 446 is in the ham band from 440 to 450. So 446, it's in the middle of the ham band. In Europe, the ham band starts at, or stops at 440. It tops out there. So by the time you get to 446, you're in something else. There's some commercial stuff around it, but sitting right around 446 is these unlicensed radios. And I decided to look up some explanations when people ask about using these radios in North America. And so there's this website, The Great Outdoors. Somebody asked, yeah, what if I use them? What's the big deal? And got a bunch of answers, but I go way down to the most appropriate answer. And the guy says, excluding the legality question, it sort of depends on who hears you. And as we hams know, these things don't go very far. Our UHF band is not very busy, even in the big cities. 446.0 is the national simplex channel, but you're not going to find anybody on it. So probably somebody could use these for PMR 446 radios over here for years, never encounter a ham. However, when I've been in some theme parks or skiing and have been listening on my ham radio on 446.0, channel one for the PMR 446 is actually, I think this guy says it right here, 446. Does he say? No, but it's just off of 446. 446, like 0625 or something. Well within the pass band of a narrowband FM ham radio. And I've heard people talk. Not a lot, but I have heard it. So clearly somebody had come over from Europe with these radios and played with them. There's really no good reason to do that. They're not cheaper over there. In fact, they're maybe a little bit more expensive. When Cindy and I were visiting in Amsterdam, there was a electronics store we stopped in the airport, and there was a bin full of miscellaneous stuff and some of these radios. And it looked just like this, but it said right on the bottom, 446. Pretty cool. As a licensed ham, I could use that here in America. And I think they've got a digital version over there. Don't know for sure, but I think they do. Okay, so give a kid, not a book, give him a radio. Let him play. We'll give him a pair. And as Jeff says, Jeff AC4ZO, the not frequent enough co-host in here and ham radio now, what they'll do is they'll get the two radios and they'll be a couple hundred feet apart. Can you hear me now? And they'll get a little farther apart. Can you hear me now? A little farther apart. Can you hear me now? Until they can't hear each other anymore. Fun to play with. Verizon stole that. Let's go to St. Petersburg, Florida, and learn about linking on P25.
Okay, so next up, I'd like to introduce David Krauss, NX4Y. His talk on the P25 Network Exchange, linking amateur P25 digital repeaters worldwide. Take it away, David.
Well, thank you very much. Happy to be here today at my first DCC. Appreciate Tapper inviting me. And it's good to see all these technical hams out here. And we're going to give a shot at doing this. I'm not much of a public speaker, but we'll see what happens. You never know. I already don't know how to run the laptop here. It's not. It has one big thing here. There's no buttons.
Right there.
Okay. Ah, there we go. Here's the first question. Who will survive? All right. We had lunch a little while ago. I'm sure everybody enjoyed their very nice $30 lunch, and it was very filling. And I know it's making you all very sleepy. And so usually what I do is I bring chocolate bars with me and I throw them out at people in the audience, but I forgot to do that this time. So you're just going to have to stay awake. So I'm going to tell you at the end which one of you has survived this apocalypse. First, we'll talk for a few minutes about what is P25. Well, P25 is a standard that was developed by the Association of Public Communications Officials, I believe it is. And their project was to come up with a standard public safety protocol that could be interoperable by different agencies. And they came up with this, I think, originally somewhere in the late 80s, and developed this system that they called P25, and it's just a standard digital protocol. It's one of the oldest voice digital protocols, relatively speaking, out there now as compared to something like D-Star or Fusion or any of those. Speaking of Fusion, you'll notice that Yaesu always seems to call it C4FM. Well, P25 was C4FM long before it was a twinkle in Yaesu's eye. But it was using that technology long before. Its primary use was and still is public safety. And right now, the Motorola Quantar is the most used amateur repeater. And the reason for that is a lot of agencies are moving to what they call P25 Phase 2, which is a little different technology, or Motorola's convinced them that they need the latest and greatest thing, and so they're moving to 700, 800 megahertz. And that has made a lot of Quantars available on the market for us, which is a good thing. The prices have been slowly coming down. And you can buy VHF and UHF Quantars for a pretty reasonable price now, and they are very, very high-quality, good repeaters. One of the problems, though, was there was no way to interface it with the rest of the world. Unlike DMR, which was out of the box, made to interface with other things, and D-Star, this being an older technology and again, a public safety-focused technology, nobody was thinking about wide area linking. Nobody really thought, well, why would we want to link these things to places all over the country or all over the world? So there wasn't a lot of external interfacing available on this. Basically, there's an internal TTL level interface on what they call the wireline card. And then it comes out to another board called a Motorola V.24 interface. And V24 specifies the physical interface only. It's RS-232 by another name. It's a synchronous clocked interface. And they actually are running HDLC over there, which is high-level data link control, which was all in vogue in the 80s. Anybody worked with that stuff? I see some people. So HDLC seemed like a grand idea at the time. 30 years later, 20, 30 years later, maybe not so much. So your options were pretty limited with this. You could do point-to-point connections over this V.24 connection via modems or via microwave link. And you could do some limited multi-point connections with another device called an AstroTAC comparator. Now, if you look at that picture, you say, that looks just like the Quantar picture you showed me a few minutes ago. And yeah, it's the same chassis, and it actually uses a lot of the same cards. And what the comparator did is allow you to do a whole bunch of point-to-point connections back to this one point, and it would do voting or combining of these different audio streams. Comparators were very expensive, and they still are. You commonly see them on eBay for $4,000, $5,000, and it's very limited. You can get a maximum of I think 16 ports on there, and that's it. And they all have to be geographically in the same zone. So some people started looking at the V.24 data and what really was in it, and this was done on a forum called communications.support. Some very bright people, a lot smarter than me, went and got some data analyzers and started looking into what was actually in this data, and they figured out that most of it was just what was called Common Air Interface Data, CAI, and they used the IMBE voice codec. You probably heard of AMBE is the later one that's being used. They use something called Enhanced Multiband Excitation. And the IMBE voice data is very simple. It's basically 9 bytes of voice data for every 20 milliseconds, and there's some headers and some terminators and other stuff. But somebody kind of figured out most of what was there, which was very important. After that, there were a couple more problems. It was still HDLC synchronous, and turning it into something that was that would work over the internet in IP was a problem. HDLC, as I said, is pretty old, and it's not widely supported anymore. You can buy asynchronous to sync asynchronous converter, but they're very expensive, multiple hundreds of dollars. He will not survive. First zombie, out of here. And then after the conversion, now you've got a nice async data stream, but you still want to get it into IP. Well, that's a little bit easier, but there's a lot of work to that. And some people attempted to do some things. It just wasn't a thing. So you ended up with a whole bunch of P25 islands out there in the world. And one of the things that really surprised me when I started this is how many people really were using P25. But it was three guys here and three guys there and four guys there. And everybody would get bored with it because you talk to the same four guys. How long can you do that? You know, especially when they're like Brian, W9CR back there. I don't want to talk to him anymore. So what was the solution? Well, surplus Cisco routers ended up being the solution. The Cisco routers have a serial interface card, and it lets you do HDLC to IP conversion, all built in. And you say, well, Cisco routers, those are expensive. Well, this is a model 1841 I'm showing here, and I just picked up four of them for $20 a piece. So, you know, this is something out of probably mid-90s vintage. Now Brian says newer.
Yeah, but I think those were brand new around 2018.
Yeah, okay, so they're much newer. There are older ones that we've used as well, but I've been focusing more on these lately. They have two Ethernet ports, two slots for the serial cards, which I think I have here. Like I said, modular HDLC conversion, serial tunneling over IP, inexpensive and readily available. We like that. There's one of the interface cards. They call that the WIC-1T. It's got a proprietary Cisco 60-pin connector. You can get a newer one that costs more money that has two proprietary littler connectors. So, your choice. And of course, with that, you can get the proprietary Cisco cable that plugs into that. Fortunately, these are all cheap. These boards are $5 or $6 now on eBay. The cables are $5 or $6, so it's not a lot of money to put into it. The Quantar interface board, on the other hand, was this little gem, which sat on top of what they called the wireline card. This was the V.24 interface. And these were made of unobtainium. They really were hard to find. And if you did find them, they were pretty expensive. So this was a problem, finding the interface board. One of the guys on the group, John ZL4JY, said, well, this thing's really pretty simple. Let's try to make a circuit for it. So he made a circuit that consisted of basically one chip. It's the same chip used on this board, and he published that, and I tried to build it, spent 2 hours screwing around with a bunch of tiny little wires and said, well, I've had it with that. And so, oh, there he is. There was the guy who couldn't find the board. So I built that. So I started making these boards. I designed a PC board layout, which was not terribly complicated, as you can see. And I had these things made at a company in China called Dirty PCBs, because they were quick and dirty. That's their slogan. And they make great little boards. And they're fast. I couldn't believe it. And they use one chip. And most guys that have done any kind of serial interfacing would say, well, why didn't you use a Max 232? Because that's what everybody would use, right? And this existing original chip uses plus and minus 9 volts. And you say, well, that's a pain. Well, it's already there. It's on the Quantar daughter board that you're plugging into anyway, so why not use it? It's simpler, it's cheaper. So it's got one chip, it's got an RJ45, and it's got a 50-pin connector that goes right into the Quantar. Once I started putting these on the website, they went like hotcakes. I've sold, I don't know, 80 of them, 90 of them. It's just amazing how many of these have gone out. And if I had known that, I would have had them sent to dirty assemblers in China, because I hand make them all now. But it's worked out really well. Well, now we got to talk about the software. Well, that was a whole nother story. But really was the key to making this all work. At this point, we had a nice little board, and you could still plug one Quantar into another one. And so using the information that was ferreted out by these other folks, I developed a system which I called Quantar Site Connect. It used one central server, which acted as a TCP/IP data reflector. It was custom coded in C#, closed source. At that point, I wasn't a believer in open source, and so I wanted to maintain complete dictatorship control, and I did. And it supported one worldwide talk group. And slowly the word got out. People started hearing about it. The first connections were from some folks in New Zealand, of all places. And I hadn't even considered international when I started putting this thing together. Well, after New Zealand came Australia. And I said, wait a minute, this is weird. There are pockets everywhere. There are pockets in Germany. There are pockets in Austria, France. So it really became something much larger than I had even thought about. And people started, you know, contacting me and wanting to connect into the system. And so it grew over time. It grew to about, oh, I don't know, maybe 30-ish or so nodes. And basically it looked something like that. It was the central server and a bunch of repeaters. Not unlike a lot of the reflectors that are out there now. One of the big differences being, though, is that the data coming out of the Quantar and going back in has been error-corrected. A lot of the stuff out there now, the reflectors out there now take the data directly from a radio, doesn't do any error correction at all, goes to this reflector and comes back, giving it lots more paths to generate more errors. This system doesn't do that. It takes error-corrected data in and error-corrected data out. At the same time, came up with a web dashboard. And the web dashboard showed, like a lot of them do, current connections to the system, how many people were connected, the things that a lot of people have seen. Last 100 transmissions was one of those. I'll zoom in a little bit. And you can see we show the talk group, which in this case is always the same, 10-100. Radio ID, call sign. One of the things also, though, is average packet time and max pack time. Because we're looking at the data every 20 milliseconds, I can make it look at how long it took the data to get there. And so when you click on one of those, you get a little histogram like that. And that's a pretty good-looking P25 timing signal. You see, each of those peaks is at the end of one of those logical data units that I showed earlier. So the average time is 20 milliseconds per frame. Then you get one that's a little longer because there's a little more data in it, and then you get one that's a little shorter. So that looks pretty darn good. One of the limitations of V1, though, actually there was a lot of them, single point of failure. If the server went down, you're out of luck. Too bad. The audio quality was not consistent. It wasn't as good as I would like. There were times when it was great, and there were times when it wasn't so great. And a lot of that depended on how far you were going and what paths it was taking to get there. It was limited to one talk group without major recoding. I had just coded the whole thing, and I wasn't enthusiastic about doing it again. I'm going to throw candy at him. He's starting to sleep. Somebody get me candy. So that's why I should have brought it. And I didn't want to recode it, so I said, well, what lazy method can I use to make this better? And I wanted to move to a distributed model. I wanted not the single point of failure. I wanted other people to have problems too, essentially. You know, I got enough of my own. I wanted to spread the joy. And then also it ran on Windows. It was a hefty Windows server with a Microsoft SQL Server database. And for some people, they don't like Microsoft. They seem to like this Linux thing. I don't get it, but, you know, takes all kinds. Thank you, though. So who am I? Windows phone over here, yeah. So then I said, after about a year, I was working on a project at work where I was sending video across some data streams. And I was working on this for a couple of days at work, and the more I worked on it, the more I said, you know, this is pretty cool. This could work for radio, too. So I started thinking more about it, and I said, let me try to put something together. So I came up with Vision 2, and about the same time, it got renamed to the P25 Network Exchange, or P25NX. And it's a distributed model. The audio is much higher quality because it's more consistent. It has inherent support for nearly unlimited on-demand talk groups, and it lets the network be the network. And what I mean by that is networks are made to route data. They're made to route packets from one place to another, and in most of the amateur systems we have now, software does that. It controls where things go. And I wanted the network to do all the hard work, and version 2 lets that happen. And also, it's much more platform independent. It'll run on that new Linux thing. And how do we do that? Well, something called IP multicast is what we used. We being mostly me. Multicast, if you haven't heard of it, it's a one-to-many system. So that reduces system bandwidth. Instead of a copy of the data that goes to each endpoint, it basically, in a perfect world, sends one copy out onto the network, and the network decides where it has to go. And it does that by issuing a join group request or a drop group request. And so what I did is I turned talk groups into multicast groups. So if you wanted to be on talk group, in this case 10100 or 10101, there's a little algorithm in there that makes a multicast group out of it. And it tells the local router, hey, I want to listen to group 10101. And that's all it has to do. The network will then route anything on that talk group down to that router. If you don't want to hear 10101, data never makes it to your router. So it really reduces the bandwidth quite a bit. And by making multicast groups the same as talk groups, it just inherently worked. It solved a lot of problems. Problem is, it's not generally supported over the internet. And we'll get back to that in a minute. Here's kind of what IP multicast looks like. There's a server sending, in this case, could be any endpoint, sending multicast traffic to a multicast-enabled router. Fortunately, those 1841s and the like that I showed earlier are multicast-enabled routers. And you see on the left side there, I think it's left, those first two have asked for that data. They've joined the group. Whereas on the right side, you see those three lonely PCs there at the bottom. They have not asked for the data. They don't want to hear it. They don't want to listen to Brian. They haven't joined the group. Okay, so now we have my IP multicast over the internet. Well, I said that wouldn't work a second ago. Oops. But it will, with dynamic multi-point virtual private networking. How many people in here have heard of DMVPN? One guy, and Brian. Brian knows everything. So while I was working on this project at work, I said, well, how can I take my work time and make it into ham radio time? And I thought, well, I can pretend to be working and actually, you know, make some progress here at the same time I'm doing this other stuff. And so I started really looking into the DMVPN. And you say, what the heck is DMVPN? It's a series of TCP/IP tunnels between unknown and known endpoints. That sounds a little scary. All right, and what that means is that the hubs, you pick up some locations that are going to be your hubs, and those have to have static, real internet IP addresses. But the spokes, which is where all the repeaters are, they can be behind firewalls, DHCP connections, mobile connections, hotel wireless, as we found out today, works. Basically, they can be anywhere. You don't have to open firewall ports. You don't have to do anything weird like that. It just works. And that's the D part. That's the dynamic part. The address can be dynamic at the spoke locations. And multipoint, one to many. And so what we do is we run IP multicast, which you couldn't run over the internet a minute ago, over DMVPN, which you can run over the internet, and you end up with this really scary looking diagram here with lots of lines and colors. And I loved this when I saw it. I said, man, this is great. If it looks this complicated, I want to try it. And so I did. And I started off with a much simpler version of this, and it worked. Me and a friend did it, and it worked great. And I said, no, that wasn't near complicated enough. I still have more work time left. And so I continued to make it more and more expanded and ended up actually with what you see here plus some. This shows two hubs, a primary and a secondary. There's your redundancy. And three spokes, which would be repeaters in this case. And they have lots of paths. They can get to different hubs. They can go to each other. There's lots of ways to get from point A to B if you want the data. Now, after seeing that, are you afraid of this yet? This girl, bicycle girl, very much is. So it's time to do version 2 software, or I had to recode it anyway. So the version 2 code was again written in C#, but this time I got a little smarter and I ran it under a system called Mono. Mono is a native .NET framework, previously called Microsoft.NET, but now just .NET. And it'll run under Linux as a native framework. It's not faked. It's not like Wine or one of those things. It really runs as a native framework under Linux. So now I could run it on Linux, meaning I could run it on a Raspberry Pi. I could run it on a BeagleBone Black. I could run it on, you know, pretty much anything. And that was another big advantage. It really cut down the hardware requirements for this thing. So this is what a repeater site looks like. How am I doing on time? You got your Quantar, and that feeds the HDLC over the V.24 connection. That goes to the Cisco router. And then one of those ports goes right to the internet. Could go through a firewall, or could go through ADSL modem, or whatever the heck you got. And on the other side, you have another Ethernet port, and that goes to your Raspberry Pi. Okay, so it's pretty simple at each site. Well, I said that, but it's a little more complicated to set up. But it looks simple on the picture, and that's all that matters. So he says, that doesn't look simple. Yeah, that's not. That's the network management system I put together to watch this thing. And that's not nearly built out near as much as it's going to be. In the middle are the two US hubs. There's one here in Tampa. There's one in, heck, I don't even know where the other one is. Somewhere near Milwaukee, I think. And they're set up to be backups to each other. There's a hub in Europe, in France, in Paris. There's a hub in Hawaii, which serves the Pacific region. They are all on high-speed, dedicated internet links between these locations. They're all at either data centers or locations that support high-speed links. The Hawaii one is at the University of Hawaii, and I forget where the Euro one is. The Euro and Pacific ones will also have backup hubs, and all these spokes you can see coming off of them, and then all the hubs have interconnections, yet another interconnection in between them. And this is a real live network management system. It'll alert me when something goes down. You can see one thing there is in a different color because that was not accessible at that moment when I took this picture. So This is another different thing about this system. It is managed. You know, it's actively managed to make sure all the pieces and parts are talking to each other. At this point, we have a lot of connections. We've got connections worldwide, and this is not an exhaustive list. We have several states, as you can see, Texas, New York, North Carolina. Detroit's not a state. It's a state of mind. Okay, well, what about Chicago? That's a state of mind, yeah. Okay, Sacramento, Florida. Okay, so Florida's got a bunch, because I live here. So Florida's got them in Tampa. Got two in Tampa. Soon to be three in Tampa. And then there's one south of here in Sarasota's the next one, and then the next one south is Fort Myers. There's one in Orlando. There's one kind of half done in Ocala, and there's going to be one in Brooksville, basically covering most of the West Coast, central West Coast of Florida, will all be on the network, and they'll be on their own talk group called All Florida. At any point, though, you can key your mic, and I'll show in a demonstration here in a few minutes, and be on another talk group. So Florida is going to be covered pretty well. Hawaii's got a pretty good network as well. They use one of those AstroTac comparators I mentioned earlier. They already had a linking system in Hawaii, but it was, again, limited to Hawaii because of the geographic nature of that. But they linked the AstroTac comparator into the system, and now they have worldwide coverage. Las Vegas, now there's a state of mind, absolutely. SoCal, NoCal, Wisconsin, and then international stuff. New Zealand, Australia, Germany, France, Austria, England soon. So a lot of different people, a lot of different connections. I've met some great people on there and have a lot of new friends that I never would have imagined that I would meet. So it's been a lot of fun. Okay, next steps. Well, here, I'll ask you this. How many of you have heard of the MMDVM? A few more. Multimode voice data modem, I think it's called. Is that right? Digital? MMDVM is a project developed by a gentleman in England. I forget his name. Somebody knows it. Jonathan Naylor. Yeah. And basically, it uses an Arduino board and a Raspberry Pi and a custom-made audio filtering board. And he's already made this thing work for D-Star and for DMAR and for Fusion, and now he wants to add P25. And he started working on it. Somehow he got in contact with me, and he really wants to make it compatible with P25NX, which I think is a great idea, because now we can take a good analog repeater and make it a good digital repeater. That doesn't mean we want every Tom, Dick, and Harry on there with a DV Mini and hotspots and all that stuff. We're really not about that. This network was really intended to be for wide area, real repeater linking. And so that's because I still maintain control of the network, I can still be a benevolent dictator. So for now, that's how it's going to work. It's going to be basically for repeaters. And but the idea that you don't have to necessarily buy a Quantar is a good thing. Quantar is a great repeater, but it's big and it's heavy, and it's sometimes just not the right tool for the job. And so being able to take a couple good mobile units a good analog repeater and hook it up, it's very attractive. So looking forward to that. Going to be adding more redundancy. More hubs will be added to it, as I mentioned before. We have at least the two U.S. hubs and at least two hubs in each of these other regions we've identified. I'm going to add some features, some cool features. I'll show you some that are in there now in a minute. But got all kinds of ideas for some interesting features. Going to enhance the website. There's a whole bunch of links on the website if you go there that don't work. And you can click on them until you're dead and they still won't work. You can click on them until you look like one of them zombie dudes, and they won't work. Because, you know, I only got so much time in the day, and I can only steal so much from my office work, and that's what happens. And also a mobile app maybe at some point for monitoring and managing your own repeater. So some cool ideas there. Hey, you made it. That's what I look like after 12 hours of coding. I got a 10. Hey, great. The website is p25nx.com or .net or .org because GoDaddy gives you a 3-for-1 deal. And I'm NX4Y at Verizon.net. Now, I'll give you a quick demo. And there's also a demo in the demo room. But this is going to be impressive. NX4Y at DCC. Oh, they made a little noise that you couldn't hear. Ah, courtesy tone. You can't do courtesy tones on P25. That's actually a P25. Yeah, somebody answered me. Is that you? Is that you back there? See, we can talk from one end of a conference room to the other. See? Can anybody else do that? No. I don't think so. See? That was pretty cool, right? Y'all are really impressed. That was great. Well, I couldn't hear you, Brian. Say it over the radio.
It goes all the way to Tampa and back.
Yeah.
That's cool.
That's cool. See? So that's really cool. Anyway, you can't do courtesy tones over P25, right? It's digital. So what I did basically is I encoded a whole bunch of different things into P25, native P25-ness, and then put it into the program so you could have cool things like telemetry. Now, what other kind of telemetry can we have? Well, let's try this.
Worldwide TAC 1.
Oh, that's pretty cool. Now I know what talk group I'm on.
Worldwide TAC 2.
So as I change and key up, it tells me what talk group I'm on. Now, the worldwide chick, she actually sounds cuter.
Worldwide.
Ah, see? Everybody needs to talk like her. But I'm going to change to another channel here for a minute, just to North America.
North America.
Okay. Now I'm on North America, and all I did is key up, which told the router, hey, I want to join this multicast group, and I want to drop the old one. Okay, so any traffic on worldwide, not even going to come to my router anymore. Okay? Only the traffic that I've asked for. And as long as I stay on that channel and talk on that channel, that's the talk group I'm going to be on. The system has a built-in little web server built in, and you can define what your default talk group is to what it's going to go to. And after X amount of seconds, it will revert back to that default talk group if you stop talking. So in 60 seconds or so, she's going to pop up again and say default revert. So these are all things that were encoded into P25 bytes that are now played back. They're resident in the Raspberry Pi, and they get played back when they need to be played back. The one for France says it in French. The one in Germany says it in German. So basically, you can make it do whatever you want. So the idea of having different types of telemetry was something I think was new on this system. And it really was important because it's very easy to lose track of what talk group that you're on. And so this really helps solve that problem. On top of that, like I said, we have different courtesy tones for different functions and features. And the guys that are out there just keep coming up with all kinds of new ideas that to implement. And so I look at most of those ideas, and I throw them right away because I don't have time to do it. But some of them are really good. And as time is going on, we're going to implement more and more of those. So that's P25NX in a nutshell. There is a room next door. There's lots of radios available for P25 surplus. They vary in price from $120 up to $4,000, you know, so you could spend as little or as much as you want. So there's plenty of radios out there, and I encourage you all to look more into P25. And with that, I think I'll take questions. Yes, Mark?
How do you select things in the network from your handset?
How do you do what?
How do you select things to do on the network from the radio?
How do you select things
like
to do.
Like talk groups, and
you
other things.
You just keep your mic. You change it. And this one I have it set up as a channel. Each channel is strapped to a talk group.
Okay, and so you have to program things
I have
the
it
radio.
Programmed, and so when I change it, yeah, it changes to that talk
North
group.
North America, tag word.
Yeah. You can select, you can program the radios to select it from a menu item. I found it easier to assign it to a channel.
Tag three.
Okay, that's Brian messing around. He just changed talk groups on me. Yeah. Do you have Germany in there? I like the way she says Deutschland. Nine. up here we have a question.
Michael in 6MEF, two questions actually. One is, can you get a French woman to speak English with a French accent? And
I think so.
And secondly, is there any comparison between this and IRLP or, say, the DMR IP Connect type features?
Yes, those are no good, and this is great. IRLP is a analog linking system. That's the number one difference. It has a different type of infrastructure behind it, and so it is quite a bit different than that. DMR is, how do I say this politically? Correct. Yeah, there's a camera and everything over there. DMR has fragmented a lot, and there's a lot of different people doing different things, and it tends to, under its original design, favor larger groups over smaller groups, talk group-wise. I can be on I've listened to DMR repeaters and be listening to two guys locally talking, and all of a sudden somebody in New York's talking over them, and the person in New York doesn't even seem to know that he's talking over them. So I don't know how that network works. It doesn't, to me, sound as good. It's half the bandwidth of P25. So out of the gate, I don't think it sounds as good. And I'm critical about that. But I don't like the way the network is just designed. And so when this was being designed, I tried to take all the issues and things I saw in that network and not put them into this. Does that answer your question?
Hi.
Jeez.
I said I wasn't going to bust your balls at all, and I'm not. But one of the important things, which I probably will be doing it a little bit here, is this is open source, and this is, which, is it GPL yet?
Sure.
Okay. It's open source. It's on GitHub. You can fork it. And one of the cool things about this, and I know Dave and I had a lot of back and forth about this, and he's come over, I think, into the light of open source software. And
can I change this to say Brian down here?
No. Anyways, one of the cool things here is if you really don't like Dave and you don't like the way he runs his network, you can take his code, you can take the way it's being run and start your own network using the same protocols. There's a separation of the software and the technology from the actual network. And that's a big thing. That's like All Starlink, the same exact concept is there. If you don't like Jim Dixon and the way he runs the network, you can start your own. And I think we're in agreement that it's probably best not to do that, because yeah, we can all get along and we can be better together than separate, but that is one of the fundamental freedoms of open source software.
Yeah, Brian's right. He was a big influence on me switching this to an open source solution. He badgered me until I said yes. And it's kind of like my wife in a way. Yeah. But, you know, he's right. Ultimately, I made the decision. I made it open source. The configuration, even for the routers, which is pretty complicated, I gotta say, is open source as well. You know, it's out there, it's published. So anybody could certainly start their own network. And even if you don't want to completely start your own network, but you want your own hub, there's a guy in California, he's got 5 repeaters, he wanted his own hub. That's fine, he can have his own hub. I don't care. I gave him whatever he needs to start his own hub. He wants the option to connect to the larger network, and he has that. All he has to do is change his radio to the talk group and key it up. But his default talk group is going to be something else. It's going to be something on his hub. And that's fine. I have no problem with that. So, it'd be better to be a cooperative network, one network, but it is open source, and you could do whatever you like with it. Anybody else? Nope. Great.
Thank you very much.
Well, thank you all very much. And we'll look forward to seeing you next door.